Hello, and welcome to KDAB News, the monthly update for professionals working with Qt, C++, and 3D technologies. I'm Robert Brock, and in this edition we have Slint 1.0 release, an interview with co-founder Olivier Goffart, KDAB at Embedded World, Qt Creator 10 beta released, tip of the month, announcements, and resources. Slint, previously called 60fps, is a cross-platform toolkit written in Rust that lets you develop fluid graphical user interfaces for any display. It can be easily integrated with multiple programming languages besides Rust, such as C++ and JavaScript. Today I speak to one of the founders, Olivier Goffart. Hello, Olivier.
Hi. Hello.
Could you tell our viewers a bit more about Slint and who can use it?
So Slint is a native UI toolkit for desktop and embedded. We architected Slint so it can be scalable across hardware, operating system, and programming language. There is a clear separation between the user interface definition and the business logic. The user interface is defined in a declarative language, which we call Slint, and it's inspired by QML. So if you're familiar with QML, you will be familiar with our language. This provides a way to describe user interface and the elements and the placements on the screen. And it is compiled by our compiler ahead of time, and then it's compiled into the target language. So the runtime is written in Rust, but we have API for it in different programming language, such as C++, also JavaScript, and we plan to add more. And this runtime is really lightweight, and it really scales across a huge range of devices. So we can even work on, so for example, here I have a demo running on a microcontrollers with only 300 kilobytes of RAM. And it doesn't have any hardware acceleration, but we can also support support embedded Linux with OpenGL, and then we work with the GPU. And we also run on desktop. So while most of our customers are using Slint on embedded device, we also work on desktop, and it's a good alternative if you're looking for an alternative UI toolkit.
Excellent. You're preparing for your 1.0 release, and that's a pretty big moment. What are the highlights in this release?
So this release is the 1.0 release. It's a culmination of 3 years of effort. We started in 2020, and since then we've made 24 releases and thousands of commits. And we can, by releasing the 1.0, we claim to the world that we are ready, that we're changing from development mode to something that can be used in production. And we can claim this because one of our first customer is going in production soon with their next generation HMI, which they've developed successfully with Slint. Of course, Slint is still young. So while the 1.0 release still has many features that you would expect, there is still a lot of things that we could claim are missing, but we're thinking that the 1.0 is a good base that can be used as a base for the future development.
That all sounds great. So how would I get started with Slint?
So you can go to our website and check the documentation. We have tutorials and other getting started guides. We also have a plugin for Visual Studio Code that you can install, and this plugin provides all you need for integration with a language, so auto completion and code navigation and so on. But also, and most importantly, it has a live preview, so you can preview your current UI that you're developing, and you can, as you type, you can see the result in real time. So that's really helpful to get a quick overview of what you're working on, and it's really important for UI development. You can also check online. We have online editor playground, so you don't need to install anything. You can try it on there. And we also have a bunch of demo running on the browser, so you can check our website.
That VS Code plugin will come in useful, as will the online editor playground. Can you give us a short outlook? Like, what are the features you are planning next?
So we already have a live preview, but we want to expand this live preview to be a full functional WYSIWYG, what you see is what you get. So a bit like the Qt Widget Designer, where you can drag and drop elements and widgets on the, on, on this preview, and that would change your code. And in the future, the goal is to even have that you would not need to have the code, that a designer himself could design the UI without touching any line of code. And the developer would just take this and feed the data to it, feed the logic in the programming language. We also want to spend a bit more time to polish the desktop integration so it can be really competitive against other desktop frameworks.
That was interesting. Thank you. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
So we are an open source project, so we invite you to contribute by peer or just issue. Please report bugs if you find them, or just go on our repository and star us on GitHub or follow us on social media.
Perfect. Well, I think everyone should go do that now. Well, thank you very much for your time, Olivier.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Embedded World will open from the 14th to the 16th of March in Nuremberg. I'd like to give you a quick preview of what KDAB will present at our booth in Hall 4, booth 302. Being a Qt Platinum partner, KDAB will, as every year, present a selection of excellent Qt-based customer showcases. One big topic is how you can build one software platform for a whole product line. We did this for our customer Spiedel, who produces a variety of brewing and fermenting devices. You'll be able to learn how we created a software platform using Qt that runs on all different devices using different hardware. Another example of this is the Miltenyi Automax, an advanced cell sorting device. KDAB is a key long-term partner for Miltenyi in developing a cross-product software platform that forms the basis for a large part of their product portfolio. Apart from that, there will be a live demo of a selection of development tools, such as Gamma Ray, Hotspot, and HeapTrack, which we have featured in various videos in this channel. With Gamma Ray, we will introspect a Qt-based game at runtime on a Steam Deck. If you're curious about that one, you'll have to come and check it out. In our R&D section, we are looking at Flutter for embedded devices, as well as other things. There will be a Flutter demo running on a Texas Instruments AM6254 board. Many of our other demos run on hardware from Toradex, and we have one demo built on top of Torizon. We'll also find Toradex in Hall 4, booth 240, if you want to learn more about their embedded boards. Find out more about all KDAB demos on the blog linked below. My colleagues will be happy to see you at Embedded World. The beta version of Qt Creator 10 has been released in the middle of February with a row of improvements in editing, projects, as well as remote build and run targets. For example, when renaming .ui files or renaming forms in .ui files, the C++ code is refactored accordingly. CMake projects now have a CMake --- install-based deployment method available, and Clang format now also works on remote files in a Docker container. And that's just to name a few. You can find the full list of changes on the release note linked below. When starting to build a first embedded Linux device, you're going from a relatively easy to understand product environment to one that's software dependent with many technical decisions to make. But how do you go about creating an embedded system that is not only successful with customers, but also a solid foundation for future innovation? To help with this process, KDAB has created a 4-part white paper series on designing your first embedded device. It covers the beginning and ending of the product deployment process. At the beginning of a new project are a handful of critical choices that shape and constrain every other decision down the line. Similar upfront decisions around your expected customer experience influence your ability to update or change your product after it's already in the customer's hands. In this white paper series, we have collected our recommendations from many years of experience with embedded Linux projects. You can pick up a paper copy at our booth at Embedded World, Hall 4, 302, or you can read it online following the link below. Hopefully, this is a valuable resource for your next embedded project with embedded Linux. From the 15th to the 18th of March, there will be the FOSSGIS conference in Berlin, a conference centered around open source software of geo-information systems. together with our partner, Schneider Digital, a full-service provider for professional 4K, 8K, 3D, and VR hardware, KDAB will demo 3D software applications on a stereoscopic display by Schneider, named the 3D Pluriview. If you want to learn more, come and check us out at the exhibition. The next Meeting C++ conference is still a way off, only taking place in November. But you might have already heard that the organizer Jens Weller is offering other formats for the community in between the conferences. One of those is a regular C++ online job fair, with the next one taking place on the 14th of March. Check out the link below if you are looking for a new job in C++. And finally, April 24th to the 28th, there will be the Embedded Online Conference, but the final schedule isn't announced yet. However, you can already see a list of approved talks. Rust offers high performance, high reliability, and strong security for embedded software, and helps developers check for and reduce memory and threading errors common to complex low-level applications. With these clear benefits, Rust is gaining popularity among embedded software developers. If you've been following our news regularly, you might have already come across CXX Qt, the Rust bindings for Qt. If not, or if you'd like to read up on it a bit more, I recommend an article that has been published earlier this month on embedded.com about best practices for integrating Rust and Qt in embedded systems. Thank you for watching, stay safe, and as always, if you've got any questions or feedback, you can post them below the video. I'll see you next time. We'll